All right. Great. Welcome to the video. The Holy Spirit has given me a lot of updated information. So I'll pass this on as best I can. First, most importantly, the Holy Spirit wants me to continue to focus on abstraction, extreme right-mindedness. It's very, very important. The Holy Spirit said, forget the art. Forget the art. It's not strong enough. It's not strong enough. We need to get familiar with pure abstraction. And so I'm back taping, focusing on pure abstraction again, as we always do. But I was doing some graphics and some art, thinking that might be helpful. But it's not strong enough. It's not strong enough. The only pure abstraction, which is really what we're doing, is we're accepting that mortal mind has never existed as some separate mind or a self-existent mind. It's spirit pretending to not be spirit. One way to put it. And then spirit denying that it's pretending to not be spirit, and therefore it has to come up with some other excuse. You know, well, what's causing this? Well, it says, oh, mortal mind. There's such a thing as mortal mind, and that's what's causing it. An egoic mind, mortal mind. There isn't any such thing. Christianity is based on dualism. It says there's both human and divine nature. That's not true. There's only divine nature. So we're getting out of this dualistic trap. I got very strong, very, very strong indications today. I got an argument almost today. It was just this frustration. And here's another thing. Don't insist upon your rights anymore, or your privileges, or your rights in this world at all. You know, don't stand up. I got to stand up for my rights. Then, no, don't do that. Just take refuge in extreme right-mindedness, which is abstraction, great abstraction, meaning abstract mind is natural mind. Abstract mind is natural mind. It's the only mind there is, actually. It's based on pure freedom. And mortal mind is a pretense. Mortal mind is what gives rise to civilization and measurements and science and inventions and materiality and all this kind of stuff. That's mortal mind. But extreme right-mindedness is abstract, which knows that mortal mind is just, it doesn't exist. It's just a pretense of eternal mind. It's a pretense of eternal mind. Now, shifting gears here a little bit. Oh, let me see. This I took this pine cone on tour. I took it on tour. I did. I was bringing it around, showing it off, and various people here and there, just, you know, whatever, strangers, you know. What do you think? It's amazing. It's like a Rorschach test, because everybody has a slightly different take on it, and which reveals their own personality. They don't know what it is. What is this? And what should you do with it? You know, it's amazing. It was extraordinary. It caused extraordinary commotions. And but the overwhelming reaction, I have to say, is they said, wow, if this hits you on the head, it would kill you. That's the overwhelming reaction from maybe about 90% of the people. And this got me thinking, you know, wow, is this also a sign? It's a multiple, it has many, and this symbol has a lot to it. We talked about it before in one of the videos about how it caused sacred gatherings to take place, where armistices were agreed upon. So we're talking about, it's a symbol for sacred gatherings. It's also a symbol, of course, the pineal gland. The pine cone has been traditionally symbol of spiritual vision. The pineal gland is supposed to be the gland of spiritual vision. With your eye be single, your whole body be full of light, Matthew something in the Bible. So it's a profound, it's always been in throughout history. The pine cone is the sacred symbol of spiritual enlightenment. And so we have here this massive, massive, massive granddaddy of all pine cones. And so you might say it's some huge, huge situation of spiritual enlightenment. Maybe, you know, bigger than one person. So, you know, bigger than that. It may be a big gathering. It may be a big enlightenment take place in the world where many come from all over the world. And there's this sort of great awakening among those who are ready to go, you know, to drop the pretense and of eternal mind trying to be greater than God, pretending to be dead, pretending not to be itself. This could also representative of a boloid. A boloid is a term that is often used, I believe, in geology or something for impacts by space rocks, impacts. And based on all of the attention getters that I've had, there seems to be I can hardly imagine that there will not be some boloid impacts at some point, seemingly, you know, within my lifetime, because it keeps getting my attention. You know, I'm sitting here taping and suddenly, bam, right over my head, like two rocks just fall right on the roof right here, and on and on and on and on and on. So I can't just dismiss all this. So, and I think it will be two. It seems to be two. What I've gotten is two impacts in the world. And I have long believed that the World Trade Centers was a precursor calling card of this boloid event, a double boloid event of the Twin Towers. It's also the sign of Jonah that Jesus talked about. The Twin Towers are these huge, glossy black structures. If you put them horizontally in the ocean, you'd think, well, they're gigantic whales. Sign of Jonah, the sign of the whale. Gigantic whales. And these gigantic whales back then, of course, they couldn't have thought of these skyscrapers rising up like this. So huge, huge black skyscrapers. They might have, if they saw it in a vision, they'd say, wow, those are two gigantic whales. So the hitting of the Trade Center by two planes, and the collapsing of the towers represents the collapsing of civilization. And of course, there was a third one that didn't, a third and a whatever it was, a fourth, whatever that was, that didn't hit anything. It was not, you know, so devastating. So there might, you know, there could be two boloid events. Now, in the Bible, it talks about, Revelation talks about, you know, that God made a covenant with Noah, as in Genesis maybe, and a covenant with Noah, the rainbow is a covenant saying, I will never destroy the world by flood again, meaning it's, and then we're told later that the world at the end of this age will be destroyed not by flood, but by fire. Oh, gee, great, you know, no flood, but fire. Now, if you look at boloid events like the Chicxulub in Yucatan Peninsula, Chicxulub crater impact, and that was the one that there was the curtains for the dinosaurs in the Cretaceous, end of the Cretaceous period, in the about 66 million years ago, right? And they pretty much say, yeah, that's what caused this extinction level event, going from the end of the Mesozoic to the Cenozoic era, which is modern, you know, mammals, animals, Cenozoic era. That's what caused it, knocked out the dinosaurs. So 66 million years ago, and by a 6 kilometer asteroid, pretty interesting 666 number there, isn't it? Mark of the Beast, 666, 66 million years ago, 6 kilometer asteroid. pretty interesting. Maybe that's the beast that causes desolation, you know, because they say that the result of such a thing is it causes some heat to rise high up and then it descends back down somehow. With all these hot particles or something somehow, and it causes worldwide fires, and they actually found carbon all over the world. They think that the entire planet burned. The whole planet was on fire from that event. And I was thinking, wow, that would be the destruction of civilization by fire. If a large enough boloid asteroid hit, it supposedly would cause, you know, not only dust but also extreme fire, burning every vegetation. It was a, you know, extinction level event in ELE. Not the biggest one, but certainly a very, very big one. Now that we're in the Holocene period, where they talk about, you know, well, this is a sixth extinction level event. We've had like five big extinction level events in history. And usually these kind of punctuate the boundary between different, you know, eras in history, as they can say, okay, this is when, you know, the huge die off, and then there was this new situation, new climate, new life, the Phanerozoic, which means life you can see, life you can see. We're in this huge epic of a super epic of life you can see, whereas before it was a protozoic, whereas just tiny microorganisms, algae, various things, you know, well, stuff that was hard to see. But then we went into the Phanerozoic era, where you know, you could actually start to see life forms. So we're in the Cenozoic. It has the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic. The old Paleozoic, the old middle Mesozoic, and with the dinosaurs, and the Cenozoic, where mammals have predominated. The dinosaurs got knocked out by an asteroid impact, along with maybe some other factors, but really got hit hard. So we're in the third phase of that Cenozoic, and then there's a couple of divisions within that. Holocene, the Pleistocene, and then the Holocene is kind of like the last 12,000 years. You know, they had Paleolithic, Megalithic, and Neolithic. So this is the Neolithic period, means the New Stone Age. We're in this period where, you know, human history, last 12,000 years, would be the Holocene Age. And you know, there's supposed to be big die-off that we've causing this sixth extinction level event by human activity in the world. Human activity is causing this huge die-off, but this is not exactly what is talked about in Revelation, which Jesus told in the Olivet Discourse, that there would be, you know, what was happened to the world would be the worst die-off ever. Nothing would survive on the planet if the days weren't cut short. So this would be something, you know, something pretty strong that they're talking about here. We're not talking about, I mean, there's a number of factors that could happen. There's a variety of stuff, really. But anyway, hopefully none of this comes to pass, but I'm getting the feeling that it very well may come to pass, that it the Cenozoic era may be coming to an end. The mammals, life on this earth may be coming to a close. What I've seen, the world's going to be remodeled into more of a fourth dimensional planet, actually. Very round, very smooth, very round, to be like terraformed by fourth dimensionals, using their genetics and DNA, you know, all this genetic engineering and high technology and stuff, that this planet is going to drastically change. So this is talked about as the, you know, the end times, tribulation period, where Revelation says that there are various, the angels throw various plagues and problems, they hurl rocks down upon the planet and stuff like that. Well, it could very well be that this happens. It wouldn't be at all surprising, and it may be actually happening very soon if that warning sign of the Twin Towers is any indication, that likely to get hit by a couple of rocks, as it were. So this keeps pelting me with, every time I ask the Holy Spirit what's going to come, I get this getting hit by rocks every time. I'm tired of asking. Oh boy, I don't want to, you know, but here it comes again. So, well, what do you do? What do you do? This is another question. If the Holy Spirit's taking immense effort to point this out, don't you think it would also take even greater effort to have a way for us to sidestep it? And indeed, this is what the Holy Spirit keeps telling me. You can sidestep it. There's a way to sidestep it. Okay, there's a way to sidestep this. Now, we are Homo sapiens, mean wise man, wise people. We're wise. Sapiens, wise. So, shouldn't the sign of wisdom be the ability to sidestep something like this? You would think so, right? I mean, does wisdom stop somewhere? I mean, no, because our wisdom is so great that we're able to recognize those who are wiser than us and ask them questions and learn from them. And there are those who tell us, hey, you know, mortal existence is a fantasy. It's a pretension. That spirit is intentionally pretending this. It's not some separate dream. It's not some separate dream that just happened to evolve. Okay, this is a lie. Spirit is actively, intentionally, willfully dreaming this, so it can pretend that it's not really spirit. And it's trying to die so that it can prove that God, that it killed God, and then therefore is greater than God, then resurrect itself from such a death and then be the new prime creator. So, but this is a willful pretension that's taking place here. The body, the earth, the life forms, everything on here is a willful pretension. Anything that is impermanent was never alive in the first place. All life is eternal life. All life is eternal life. God only creates eternal life. So everything that is created is alive forever. Now, another shifting gears a little bit. We're kind of like driving this great car that, you know, we'd be able to shift gears fast, slow, exotic race car. I'm having a hard time sleeping these days. The tension seems to be extraordinary right now. I also did this I thought was beautiful graphic video of Ron Maharshi. Silence is also conversation, which I thought was a tremendous, I never caught that before, that indeed it is it not? Silence is also conversation. And that video just happens to be just complete happenstance. I didn't even notice it till I clicked on it to play it on YouTube, and I said, look, I said 9/11. The length of it is 9/11. Okay, now, this is quite interesting. Of course, I remember back in 2001, I believe. 9/11, what happened then, was the sign of Jonah, the sign of what is to come, World Trade Center, getting hit. So I wonder if this 9/11 now is actually going to be something to help us sidestep what this was referring to, like a spiritual 9/11. Why can't we not have a spiritual 9/11? Think about that. A spiritual 9/11. Silence is also conversation. Silence is also conversation. Very profound. So, a spiritual 9/11. It's coming up pretty soon. What's today? I think it's like the 3rd. Yeah. So, so it would be next Friday, not this Friday, but the next Friday, I guess. Getting very close to this. September has already been an extremely intense month, ridiculous. So I couldn't sleep last night. Just my nerves were just way too. The central core of my body was just so nervous, and I mean, it was, the wow was so intense, so intense. Maybe doing these graphics of Ron Maharshi was so intense that it just lit me up in some way. Now, here's a saying that I would reintroduce to the world. Very important. God shines as everything and remains as nothing. God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. God both shines as everything and remains as nothing. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Okay, so everything we're seeing is God. This is the shining of God. It's the shining of God, actually. And yet also, God remains as no thing at all. And the two are not separate. Each one is within the other. It's concurrent. It's simultaneous. It's concurrent. God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. Very abstract way of practicing and extremely powerful. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So we're able to view everything in as God, because God, we're extension of God. So we experience the same way God does, which is that everything is the living light of God, that is God, shining as everything, but also we as God are also remaining as nothing. So there's nothing that makes an impact upon us, an impression, an impact upon us. No matter what it is we're experiencing, it never changes this remaining as nothingness, which is the root of God. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So the issue is that there's no impact. There's nothing that makes an impression upon God. There's no impression. The remaining as nothing is absolutely seamless and smooth. It's like a duck. The duck can walk about in the rain, but it's smooth feathers. Everything just, you know, the rain just rolls right off. So in the rain, but, you know, untouched by the rain, as it were. So God is shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Concurrently. This is the vision that we can have. This is the experiencing that we are able to have. This is the abstract experiencing we're able to have. And of course, this is very abstract, right? So this also ties right in with the practice that we've been doing, which is, yes, I'm both this and not this, right? I'm both the appearancing and not the appearancing, shining as everything, remaining as nothing. This is, so the essential practice of God is to say, I'm absolutely this and absolutely not this. This is basically a way of conceptually pretending yourself for experiencing God. Back shifting gears now to this situation of extreme right-mindedness. A lot of commotion here. Interesting. I dreamed of a truck coming here last night. It's doing something. Anyway. The right-mindedness. I had an experience of, also today, of being pinched by a big truck on the left, going around a sharp turn, and in making the turn, it was pushing cars off the road to the right. They couldn't get past, and I had to stop, and the truck had to stop too. It was a big trouble, and the truck in front of me almost got hit by the other truck. So that which is on the left is going to really pinch that which is on the right, and we're not talking only politically. We're talking as far as concreteness is going to try and really crush abstraction here, which is right-mindedness. Right-mindedness refers to non-dual abstraction, that there's only one nature, which is divine nature. There's only one God. God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. There's not two gods. There's not a God of appearances and a God of non-appearances. God of manifestation and God of non-manifestation. So there's not God-goddess. That doesn't exist. That's duality. That's duality. There's only one God. There's only one God. God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. Both the manifest and unmanifest is the one God. There are not two gods. There's not God goddess. This is a pretense, a self-delusion, an intentional delusion on the part of spirit. So we're going to, those on the who have going for abstract mind are in danger, as I've been saying, of being crushed. This is the plan of the New World Order, is to crush abstraction entirely and insist that there's two natures, or just material nature, that mortal mind is all that there is. That's what they're, you know, ultimately hoping to convince everyone of. So shining as everything, remaining as no thing. Shining as everything and remaining as no thing. Simultaneously shining as everything and remaining as no thing. God is simultaneously shining as everything and remaining as no thing. The analogy is made of the ocean and waves. You know, this is sort of a crude analogy. But the waves, you know, do not depart from the ocean. It's still the ocean, isn't it? It's not like there's waves and there's the ocean. No, there's the ocean as waves and the ocean as no waves. So as the ocean produces waves, it's simultaneously not having waves. The quietness of the ocean, right? That's there too. So we're looking at waves. Oh, look at those waves. But what we forget is that the rest of the ocean is quiet, right? It's not having waves. So God's shining as everything, all these things, everything there is that seems to be appearing, but also simultaneously remaining as nothing. This is God. This is God. That's what God is. This is what we are. This is what our awareness is. So we can have this awareness. This is our natural awareness of, we see appearance shining as everything, and yet also we're remaining as nothing. Oh, finally that truck turned its engine off. Good Lord, it was on for a long time here. Spiritual 9/11, shifting gears again. We're like driving in this sports car. So driving on road, downshifting, upshifting, fast, slow down, that kind of thing. Which makes it more interesting than the graphics. There's no question about it. I get it. This is more powerful than just sort of a graphical display. I mean, some people like that graphical display, but I think most like more of like a live situation where there's more dynamics present. Spiritual 9/11. I feel extraordinarily jittery right now. I don't know why. Lot of strain. I have been watching the news. I don't know what's going on. It doesn't matter. We need to go crystal clear. We need to go right-minded as far as possible, and right-mindedness as abstraction as we possibly can, and take refuge in that. Take refuge in this abstract-mindedness. Do not insist upon rights. Like, this is my right. I have a right to this. I have a right to that. Legal rights, property rights, legal rights, personal rights, all this stuff. Very important, because this will pull us into conflict. This is what's pulling people into conflict. Hey, you just violated my rights. Somebody jumped in line in front of me today. It's like, insisted on it, and I said, wow, they let their buddy in, and I got stuck, and they said, hey, you can't go, I'm gonna let my buddy in, and then I said, wow, okay, and then someone else jumped in line in front of me, and I finally said, hey, wait a minute, yeah, that's two, that's not right, I said, what's going on here, and I tried to assert myself, and then I realized, hey, this is wrong, this is what the situation is teaching me, stop being assertive in the world, stop being assertive. A lot of commotion. No need to be assertive in the world right now. Drop the assertion of trying to say, I have a right to, you know, say this or say that. Or, you know, don't be assertive. Just go to vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is like one nature, right? We just have one nature, not two. That's pretty simple. We just have one nature. It's not a vision of high-mindedness. It's just a vision. There's just one mind. There's one divine nature. There's not human and divine nature. There's one divine nature. Pretending that it's not divine. Pretending that it's mortal. But a pretense does not produce a separate, you know, mind. We cannot create a separate mind from what we are. There's no such creation. The extension is always extension of what we are. God extended itself as it is, as what it is. And we are also that, therefore, and so we extend ourselves as God, same as God, what we are. We cannot create a separate mind. There's no such creative capacity at all in us. Lots of stuff are popping up. Wow. Now, I pay attention to the Holy Spirit because I've had thousands of times in my life where I've predicted that the future has been predicted accurately for me. Most notable was 9/11 back in 2000, whatever it was, 2001, I believe. That one I was aware of about almost at least 6 months in advance, if not a little bit more. I was shown the basics of what was going to happen, and I was completely freaked out. I didn't understand. I said, just something horrible is going to happen in the world. And then right before it happened, several days, I think, I was shown particulars, very, very clear particulars of what was actually going to happen, you know, inside the plane, everything. And then I knew, I was just in dread. I was in terrible dread for about a month, maybe. No, I think I was shown like this a month before. It was like about a month. I was in a state of extreme fear. Goodbye, truck, I hope. And I thought I was going to die, for sure. I thought I was going to be the one attacked, you know. And the Holy Spirit told me after that, stop taking this personal, you know. Stop taking this personal. If you get something like this, don't take it personal. Because I was terrified. And then when the event happened, I said, oh, that's exactly what I saw in the dream, what I was shown in the dream. Exactly. So, doggone it, there it is. So that was shown correctly. Then the Boxing Day tsunami, the Indonesian tsunami, I was also shown that, I think, about a year in advance. And I actually, this time, I'd really tried to warn people about this. I said, there's going to be a huge tsunami, terrible. Nobody paid attention. Nobody paid attention. I've realized in my life that trying to warn people is basically futile. Now the truck is still hanging around. Interesting. It's futile. It's futile. It's futile. It's almost like a waste of time. And I wasted my life trying to warn people about what's to come, and they're just on autopilot, you know? Mortal minds on autopilot. Huh. So I was right about, I was shown that accurately, very, very accurately. And then the Ukrainian conflict, I pinpointed that, I think, almost to the day. The recent stock market instability, I pinpointed certainly to exactly to the day. It was pinpointed exactly to the day. I don't know what's going on with it now. I stopped watching, but I know there's a lot of volatility. And I said that in June 22nd, I'd say that was, you know, where this 215, June 22nd, I said after this day, look out. The volatility is coming in the world. And that's, in hindsight, this is shown to be exactly right. So I don't have any specific date for any sort of asteroid sort of thing. No, I don't. Right at this moment, I don't have any predictions to make exactly. I don't have anything in specific, but I do say the indications are towards some sort of a spiritual awakening, some sort of the presence of eternal life being available for us here. This is what I'm getting. Also getting the turmoil is going to become significantly worse. Well, the desert storm, the storm I saw, that terrible storm is coming. Very heavy, very bad storm. Thunderstorm. You know, thunder and lightning, a very, very heavy storm. So, but no specifics. I think, you know, when you see a storm, it's a general thing, right? Just lots of dark clouds, terrible rain, and, you know, just a massive storm. Very stormy, you might call it, like very stormy seas, for instance. If you had a dream with extremely stormy seas, you would say, wow, a time of great storminess is coming upon the world. And then, if that's true, you don't have to break it down, well, you know, which wave is bigger than some other wave. And when you have extreme storminess, you know, that's all you need to know. That's all you need to know. Any intelligent person would say, that's good enough. That's good enough for me. I get it. Take refuge. If it's, you know, like if there's a ship out in the ocean and you say it's going to be extremely stormy conditions, what's the ship going to do? The captain's going to say, hey, I'm going to go find a port and get in and find the nearest port. Any port in a storm, you know, avoid the storm. It's not going to say, well, you know, could you give me the exact heights, wave heights you think, and how much chop, and the wind speed, and detail after detail after detail. You know, the forecaster might just say, hey, listen, Captain, it's going to be, let's just say, extremely stormy, you know, extremely dangerous conditions. The captain will say, okay, it's good enough. Stop badgering them, you know, for detail, 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 give me details, give me details. like, well, maybe I can try to, you know, write it out. No, this is not the kind of storm you try to ride out, Captain. And so this is the one you head for harbor. But of course, we want to head for the right harbor that will shelter us from this. Now, getting back to this idea of impact, that God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So nothing that appears makes any impact on God remaining as nothing. This is impossible. What we're trying to do as spirit is we're trying to impact God. We're trying to change God. We're trying to make an impression upon God. You know, that would then God would no longer be God. So what we're doing is we're pretending to be dead, so to speak, is pretending to not be what we are, is we're pretending to be have reactions or impressions. We impress, we have impact, stuff has impact upon us. Whereas when we experience as God, it's both delightful and yet also peaceful, as if there's no impact being made. Everything is fresh and new and delightful every moment, but there's no lasting impact. This is the true experiencing that we're created as. But what we're doing here, with this belief system of mortality, mortal mind, is we appear to be affected and stuff, at least lasting traumas and impressions upon us like this. So we're really trying to traumatize, we're trying to traumatize God by traumatizing ourselves, mortal mind being traumatized. All these thoughts that we have, they're really trauma. They're really trying to prove that we are impacted by something that leaves a permanent residue, trace and residue. Right? That's the thoughts are the residue and traces of imagined impacts upon reality. That's all that they are. As Ramana Maharshi said, you know, the stream of the flow of thoughts will only end when you no longer take any interest in them. Very profound. So all these reactions, emotions, and thoughts that we have are just imaginary residue and traces of what we think impact events upon God. We believe that the things that happen in this world are impacting reality, and that they're leaving a permanent, you know, scar, a residue, a trauma, a trace of it. And these the debris of this impact are our thoughts, reactions. And so we carry them with us. We're afraid to let go of them because they're the proof. They're the proof that there's some impact event did take place. Impactful events took place upon, quote unquote, our life. This is all a pretense, though, 100% a pretense. You wonder why these great teachers, like ducks, water off, everything's water off a duck's back, nothing bothers them. No, they're not impacted by anything. I say, how's that possible? Well, because all impact is pretense, pretending. And we can stop pretending, and then we realize nothing impacts God. God shines as everything, remains as nothing, always. Traceless, baseless, traceless, no residue. So we can let go of our thoughts. There won't be any residue at all. There already is no residue. This is pretend residue. Pretend residue. We're pretending. So this gives us the leverage that we need. Said, wow. Yeah, if I see that nothing has impacted reality, I have this experience, the vision of oneness. Wow, I'm aware that, oh, everything is completely fresh, untouched, unimpacted. And then if we think, what's my reaction to seeing this, as if seeing this is impacting it? And then you'll go back into thinking and reactions. But seeing that reality is not impacted by anything does not impact reality. So I think this is the conundrum we need to overcome, that seeing that nothing, no appearing and events, whatever, impacts reality at all. God shines as everything, what remains is nothing. Seeing this does not then impact reality. It still remains as it is too. But if we think, oh, this has impacted it, well then what are the thoughts, reactions from this impact? I need to use those as evidence as seeing, that I had an impactful seeing, I had a breakthrough, that impact reality is a very important breakthrough, and this is the evidence, the proof that I've had that. But then we go back into thinking and thoughts. So to abide in this is to realize that there is no impact. Enlightenment does not produce any impact at all. It's not like we're going around impacting people. It's we're going around not impacting them. It's showing there isn't any impact. Reality, nothing impacts reality. This is what gurus are saying. They say, look, nothing impacts reality. No matter, you cannot impress reality. You cannot impact it at all. You can only delight in it. You can only abide and delight in it. You cannot impact it. The attempt to impact it is the I. I impact. And the thoughts are the evidence, we call it the psyche of the I. The reactions and thoughts are the make-believe imaginary evidence or proof that that reality has been impacted in some way. So to fan this out in a broader context, as far as our history is going on right now in the future, it seems to me that we're going to attempt to have impactful, this is a very impactful time. We're trying to have an impact upon reality. Now, an asteroid would be an attempt, our attempt to make an impact upon reality. This impacts civilization. And so say, look how severely civilization has been impacted, how life has been impacted. All, of course, fantasy, all folly. And yet we do this. Those keys out of there. So the problem with this is we can theoretically know that nothing impacts God. However, if some asteroid were to hit here and it would see the impacts upon everything in this world, we would draw we have this belief, it would strengthen our belief that in proof of impacting God is possible. And this is the trouble. This is the trouble. Ideally, if you were perfectly enlightened, you wouldn't be bothered by it at all. No, you'd say nothing is, I can plainly see God is shining as everything remains as nothing. Doesn't matter if an asteroid impacts the world. It makes no difference at all. But those are the ones who are already enlightened. What about those of us who are close to enlightenment, but not yet enlightened and not yet perfectly abiding, feeling absolutely no continuity issue whatsoever with us? You see, what about us? Well, we're still vulnerable to having our beliefs system have this imaginary impact and believe in the evidence, which would be thoughts and emotions, the reactions. We'd still be vulnerable to reactions to this, which is why it's important to sidestep this. Be humble enough to realize, hey, I'm not established in enlightenment yet, which means that the world, that this dream can still impact me to believe in impactfulness. Because of all the so-called manufactured evidence, the believed in evidence. So it's very important to sidestep it. And not risk trying to say, well, you know, this is a great opportunity for me to try to be enlightened. I don't think it would be a very great opportunity, because there would be overwhelming dream evidence of the world being impacted. If you think the world is God, I mean, remember, God is both shining as everything and remaining as nothing. So you can't say, God both is the world and isn't the world. God both is the world and isn't the world. God is both everything and nothing. Just because you impact the world, that's just, you're just changing appearances. But that doesn't, God still remains as nothing. It doesn't change the nature of God in the slightest bit. It just, there would be some severe changes of appearancing. That's all. Asteroid hit, well, it's a different appearance. You know, crater, there's a different appearance than it was before. Dust, it's a different appearance than it was before. You know, food failure is a different appearance than before. You know, global, you know, winter, dust winter, different appearance than before. So the appearancing would be, you know, playing, kaleidoscopically playing, changing, but the nature of God wouldn't be changing the slightest bit. But we might believe that it is, and so it's easy to get hooked into the false belief system, dualistic belief system, when there's some severe extinction level events or severe, you know, changes and impact what seems to be impactful at the level of appearances. What seems to be impactful at the level of appearances, not realizing that God is both shining as everything and remaining as nothing simultaneously, not two distinct natures at all. So the Chalcedonian creed that Christianity adopted was a dualistic mortal mind creed entirely. They kept trying to figure out, well, how can we step this down to mortal mind? How can we help mortal mind? It wasn't designed to help mortal mind. It was designed to help eternal mind, spirit, realize that mortal mind was just a dream, a pretense. It wasn't designed to be a mortal mind religion or teaching. So there need not be any struggle at all about, well, how do we combine the two natures? You know, no. There aren't two natures. So they were struggling to figure out, you know, by what mechanism are these two distinct different natures combined as one, and how are they one? You know, they said, well, it's all a mystery. hypostatic union, it's a mystery. That somehow the essence is unionized by faith. Faith, I guess you might say. No, there's no two natures. There's no hypostatic union. There's no need for faith in some union of two distinct natures, human and divine, mortal and divine, mortal and eternal. It's just one nature. It's eternal. Eternal nature, just pretending, playing dead, like playing possum. You don't, it's like you look at a possum, looks dead. You don't have a, he said, well, I had a live possum, and I have a dead possum. There's a live, no, the possum is not dead. It's just, and it's still alive. It's still alive. It's just playing possum. So we're continuing here to focus on abstract. If you can focus on this, then you're able to be, you know, comfortable with abstraction, looking at it this way. I mean, there's something is obviously emergent because I'm feeling so much anxiety within. It's really extraordinary. Silence is also conversation. Silence is also conversation. Full stop on the wow is also progress. It's the best progress. What's... Huh. Okay. Full stop on the wow is also progress. Practicing, yes, I am both this and not this. I am both the world and not the world. Very, very, very helpful practice, because God is both shining as everything and remaining as nothing. This is God, singular nature. This is it's not dual nature, it's a singular nature. So if you have no problem in seeing this as just, this is a singular nature, then you're ready to escape duality. I don't have any trouble seeing that as singular. It's God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. There's no time needed for this. As soon as we put time into that, okay, well, you know, where did you go from, how did you get from shining as remaining as nothing to shining as everything, and how do you get back from shining as everything to remaining as nothing? As soon as you put an interval of time in there, you're trapped in delusion, duality, self-delusion, or space. Time, space, process, or form, any of those. No, it's right now. God is shining as everything, remaining as nothing. It's like pure potentiality. No matter what appears in pure potentiality, it never loses its 100% pure potentiality. It hasn't lost its totality. The nature, in other words, there's no trace within pure potentiality. No matter what arises, it leaves no residue or trace, either arising, sustaining, or subsiding. It leaves no trace at all. It's completely traceless. No residue, completely traceless. pure potentiality in which anything can arise or not arise and remain sustained forever or not. And yet that doesn't deplete the pure potentiality at all. It's like an idea. You know, no matter how much you express an idea, the idea is not depleted by the expression of it. So God is not depleted by the expression, any expressions that arise. Pure potentiality remains, you know, keeps its potency entirely, no matter what arises from it or doesn't arise. No matter how long something is sustained or not sustained, the rising, sustaining, and subsiding are all the same. They do not change the nature of pure potentiality at all. They do not make an impression upon it. So this is what we feel. When we feel this, then we feel eternal life. We're feeling God. We're experiencing God. And this can very well dawn upon us. This is what I've sought my entire life. This is what I want. I want to see the world differently through the eye of eternal life. So the nature of God never changes at all. The fundamental nature of God is always omnipresent and never changes. So we do not have to worry about our thoughts or our reactions. This is not changing the nature of God at all. So in looking at this, I'm getting little glimpses of it, and then they kind of, they're fleeting glimpses, and then they kind of go away. But fleeting glimpses are very, very good. That means, you know, it's kind of like it's right there, and you kind of just take a quick look, and you realize, oh, it is there, you know, just a real quick fleeting glance, just a real quick fleeting glance. But you say, oh, it is there. Okay, so then you just full stop on the wow. You don't retreat away from it. You just let the wow be there. Let it evaporate, subside. Maybe the strain, nervous strain, is because we're so close here to it. You know, I feel like, wow, I'm right there. Wow. And that's probably what it is. And when we have this wow reaction, we may forget what the fleeting glance, what led to it, you know. Say, what happened? Well, don't struggle with trying to remember. Don't struggle trying to remember. It's a defense mechanism of continuity fear that kind of blanks you out, temporarily blanks you out. So just stay positive in gratitude. Say, hey, I'm so close. This is great. Very grateful that I know the vision of God will soon be mine. Glasses half full means stay confident and with gratitude. So you hit a high water mark, and then, you know, the water subsides for a while. And this is, you just have to put up with this and not struggle. And I just experienced this, and I got a very good glimpse into the vision of oneness and how easy it is, you know, to understand, actually. And then this kind of shocked me. I said, wow, I'm really, really getting so close. And then this ends up being shocking, right? I mean, if you really see that you're super close to enlightenment, then you're going to get a shock from this. This is why you have to manage the success on the path. It's not like you'll just say, oh yeah, I'm super, super close. Could even be today or tomorrow or whatever. I mean, I'm so close. Oh, okay. You know, no big deal. And, you know, it's like I've always been this close. No, this is such a big deal that when we get really close, it is really going to hit us hard. And we have to just realize this. This is the wise ones who realize that continuity fear. The foolish ones reject it and say, no, I don't have that. Then they follow the ego, because the ego is their friend that tells them, no, you don't have that. Those who don't want to acknowledge the continuity fear are always looking for the friend, a friend that will agree with them. And that friend that agrees with them is the ego. And then they become buddy buddies with the ego, and the ego is not someone you want to be a buddy with. The ego is a terrible opposite of a friend. Opposite, you might call it the ultimate enemy. Enemy of sanity. So we just say, no. I don't want the ego's a friend. I don't want the ego's a friend. No. I'm going to believe that there is this continuity fear. And this is what's holding me up. And so I'm going to work on that. I will work on this. I won't listen to the ego when it says, take it easy. You know, you're overestimating it. No, I'm not. I'm underestimating it, if anything. Underestimating it. I mean, it's taken a lifetime working on it for me. And this is what the great teachers tell us. You know, spend a lifetime on it and see how far you get. Maybe you'll get enlightened, yeah. If you really work at it, there's nothing that can, you know, will prevent it. Ramana says, keep on working with the light that you have, that's available to you. Keep working with that as best you can. And he said, the master will find you, because the master is also looking for you, searching for you. And are you really working at it properly? So you might call it September strain. I'm suffering from September strain. Oh. We just need to taste this experience and taste and see it for ourselves. Taste and see it for ourselves. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. And of course, God is a feeling, not an intellectual answer. God is a feeling. Eternal life is a feeling. But we call this feeling bliss. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing simultaneously, as one, not separate, not two separate dynamics. It's just that pure potentiality is never affected by whatever we want to appear out of it. It's an idea. Ideas don't get depleted because we express the idea. You might feel this strain, it releases in various twitches or something. Yeah, various nervous releases. I'm having a number of those. There's really something profound going on. There's no question about it. The strain is profound right now. Most likely transitioning, perceptual transition from dualistic perception to vision of oneness. The right nowness of everything is not producing any effect at all on God right now. The arising, the abiding, and the dissolving are not producing any effect on God at all. And this is the great stability that we're aiming for. Instead of trying to judge, well, what is producing an impact and what is not, and how much or how little, there's no more need for that judgment at all. There isn't any impact. It's zero. So you just abide in that zero judgmentalness about God. You don't have to defend God or protect God in some way. You know, like, hey, don't do that. You know, you don't have to be righteous saying, this is what bothers God, this is what impacts God, this is what doesn't. Nothing impacts God. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So what do we have to go around policing people for? Telling what they can and can't do, you know, as far as spiritually, as far as impacting God. Doing here? I reached an hour. That's good. Extreme strain. But we're working through it here. This is what we have to do. We have to work through it right now. This is a really tough time. Tough, you know. As I feel I was right on the money, the Holy Spirit, as far as this September, I can feel it's, wow. Are we under pressure or what? Very unusual for me. God appearing as everything, remaining as nothing. God appearing as everything, remaining as nothing. God appearing as everything, remaining as nothing. Simultaneously. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. This is the heart of vision. This is the heart of vision. This is the heart of vision. So we're right, you know, right at the heart of it. The only thing else to do is to actually feel it, experience it. Silence is also conversation. So all thoughts are alike to God. They're all God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So all thoughts have equal impact upon reality. So let thoughts arise and sustain and subside. And fine. We can just about continue to abide as God, as the perception, God's perception, shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Now, when this experience of feeling dawns upon us, then, you know, we're abiding in vision. Now, to go back once again and reiterate, what is the one stumbling block left would be thinking that your abiding in vision has some impact upon God. And therefore, you're going to have pay attention to reactions from that, thoughts and reactions, feeling, emotions, thoughts, emotions, imagination. Then you would focus on those as proof that you did something extraordinary, had an impact on God, even as a positive impact. So if we say here, you know, give up all your concepts, cancel all of them out, the good and the bad and the ugly and the beautiful, there's no reaction. God remains as it is. God shines as everything, remaining as nothing. There's no impact upon God. So that's why there's this peace of mind. Now, why does one reach vision? Well, they made it their business. This is their all-important goal. Here, which is what I've done, is all my all-important goal. I want to see the world in a different way. I want to see it the way it should be seen, not this way from mortal mind. That is just designing, believing in impact. All this is impactful on God somehow. All this stuff that's arising, this appearing and disappearing, is somehow having an impact on God. Arising as every shining as everything, remaining as nothing. This dream is having no impact on God. It's a dream designed to give us the impression of impactfulness. And yet it's having no impact on God. So at every moment, God is shining as everything and remaining as nothing. This is always true. Every moment. This is right now, this instant, this is true. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Not two separate processes. See, we say conceptually, shining as everything, remaining as nothing, it sounds like there's two different, there's a process here. No, there's no process. It's singular. God both is shining and is not shining. God is both remaining as nothing and not remaining as nothing. You know, cancel out concepts around this, so we can feel it, experience it. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. Not this instant God is shining as everything, and the next instant God is remaining as nothing. That's duality. That's time. So we said, do you mean that the impactfulness is of each moment is the same? Well, it's zero impactfulness. So yeah, it's always zero impactfulness. Well, we think, well, we're trying to learn how to be impactful. I mean, what does this world tell you when you come in this world? All right, welcome to the world. So what kind of impact are you going to make upon the world? Of course, this is what they say. You're here to make an impact. Do something great, make an impact, whatever it is. You know. And of course, you know, if you said no, you cannot impact reality, it's impossible, they'd say nonsense. That we've been impacting it for, you know, forever here. Look at all the impactful stuff that's happened and done, taking place here. But the truth is that there's been no impact at all. There's only God shining as everything, and remaining as nothing. That's all that there is. And of course, abstraction, you know, sees this. It's not tripped up by words. Abstraction is not tripped up by words. Mortal mind is very much tripped up by words. And struggles with words one way or the other. Always finds something not quite right. But the abstract mind says, no, it's just pointing, you know, in the right direction. That's all. It's just a pointer. Why get hung up with specifics as a pointer? It's like, you know, it's like, how do I get out of this dark, deep forest? You just point, well, go right in that direction. Okay, thank you. And just go in that direction. You don't say, well, wait a minute now. You mean go in the direction of this tree? Well, what about this tree over here? Is that a better direction or that one there? And, you know, each tree you're saying, no, just a general direction. Just go in this direction and you'll get out of the forest. That's all you need to know. It's all that is that we need to know. So we're just abiding here in the wow of this, the strain of this. In a mood of gratitude. In a manner, not querulousness, but gratitude. Mood of gratitude. So the mood here is a mood of gratitude because we will have the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, the vision of God. We absolutely will have it. So how can we not be grateful for this? And gratitude for this ultimate stability of God which is coming, like Ramana Maharshi. Now, you see the stability there. One day you notice how stable he is, how stable his mind is. How do we get that stable mind? This is the question I've been asking. How do we experience a mind that is stable like that? Wow. And he says, absolutely you will. Here's some pointers. And just, You go over pointers. I do random reinforcement. Random reinforcement is the best kind of reinforcement. We may say things over and over and over, but interspersed, you know, seemingly randomly without any pattern to it. So the mind cannot lock onto some pattern and start being predictive and then becoming academic, scholarly, scientific, academic. Oh, I see a pattern here. Instead of just taking pointers as a pointer and going the direction, it's trying to find some pattern. Okay, well, okay, I'm going to predict what's coming next. And this is not the spiritual path at all. It's wasting time and being academic that way. So if you just repeat an exercise sometimes over and over, you know, the mind starts saying, I think I know what's next. I don't need to do it. I know what's next. But if it's just sort of randomly reinforced, you know, then that gives you, you know, it gives you a way to avoid falling into this trap. Don't really know what's going to be said, which helps keep you centered and out of the egoic mind. That's why I don't have a script. I don't know what I'm going to say. And the ego's always trying to say, okay, you said this, now the next thing to say then will be this. This comes from that. And I say, no. I maybe just be quiet. Silence is also conversation. I'm getting a lot of reaction in my solar plexus, that is for sure. Like impact. Or the releasing of the notion that any impact's ever taken place. We contract our body as if an impact is taking place in our spirit, but our spirit can never be impacted by anything. Spirit believes that some sort of can change the appearance of. Spirit believes that the changing. Let me see how to put this. We have believed that we've made impacts in upon the body, the contraction, as if an impact took place upon spirit. But really, no impact has taken place, so we can let go of this contraction. We don't have to keep trying to generate false evidence. It's only false evidence. We don't need these thoughts and reactions at all. It's just useless false evidence. Proof of nothing. Ultimately, this, by extension, we don't even need the body at some point. Again, just as a device to try to manufacture false evidence is all, you know, really is. We can use it as a communication device, but even then it's limited, so, yeah. So all these thoughts and emotions are just evidence of false evidence of duality. That there's two natures, that appearance also is separate from remaining as nothing. That it's not all one, just one. So this pine cone was certainly coming from a conifer. It was back there in the Jurassic period, and then maybe the Tertiary. I mean, I believe that was Triassic or Tertiary. Is it Triassic? Yeah, maybe it's Triassic. Triassic, Jurassic, and Cretaceous, which means chalk. Triassic. The Jurassic ended. I mean, it goes back to like hundreds of millions of years ago, which is during the Mesozoic era. Most of the vegetation was conifers, and conifers are like the most ancient trees just about there are. Can you believe that? Conifers, you know, isn't that extraordinary? They're still here. These conifers have a very, very basic form of tree life, and they've been here for hundreds of millions of years. So these pine cones are falling, been falling for hundreds of millions of years. And I'm telling you, every time I take this up, that just the incredible weight of this is just absolutely amazing. Feels like lead. I mean, you talk about something that is absolutely solid. I mean, what in the world could be causing such heaviness? Well, we're very heavy times, aren't we? Various, lots of commotions today. Lots of commotions. People in motion, yeah. More commotions. More commotions, which is fine. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. This is the real perception, the true perception that we have a right to. It's our inherent and true perception. The idea of perceiving impacts as impactfulness is false perception, completely false perception. The God shining as everything, remaining as nothing means nothing is impacting God. Nothing is impacting, nothing whatsoever. It's not that God is being impacted and recovering. There's no impact. Meaning there's no loss. Meaning what? No change. No change, no loss. No impact, no change, no loss. Meaning the pure potentiality of God is not suffering any change at all. It's remaining absolutely 100%, and there's no even the tiniest exception of that. So God is shining as everything. Without any exception, there's no exception. Everything. God is shining as everything, not even the tiniest exception. And God is remaining as nothing, no exception. It's not like there's something that God it is actually, you know, not is remaining as something, some tiny thing, that the shining is somehow remaining as something. No. God is simultaneously remaining as nothing. Does a wave change the overall potentiality of the ocean for more waves? Does the fact that a wave arises, is that somehow depleting the ocean of its ability to give rise to other waves? No, because doesn't the wave subside back into the ocean? Even when it hasn't subsided, is the ocean somehow unable to give rise to other waves? But this analogy, you know, is only, you know, it's a pointer. But of course, you could become concrete-minded, left-mindedness, concrete-mindedness, and say, well, yeah, I mean, you could measure in fact that there's a wave that does infinitesimally deplete the ocean's ability to give rise, it can't give rise to exactly the same amount of waves, so its potential has been some. So you could look at it that way if you're left-minded and didactic and argumentative and all this kind of stuff. But that's what we stay out of. We stay right-minded. And we know this is just a pointer. Whereas ideas don't lose. How does the idea of a wave, you know, deplete the idea of another wave? How does it change in any way? Cannot. One moment. So, mucho kaboom. Just think about this. How does that idea of a wave, how's that having the idea deplete the idea of having another wave? Or the idea of a wave again. How is it depleted? It's not depleted. In fact, you might say it's strengthened. There's idea of a wave, an idea of a wave, an idea of a wave. The ideas are not depleted. Ideas don't leave their source. They remain ideas. We're an idea in the mind of God. So we might think this is all very abstract. It is, and it's all very true. This is what the great teachers, including Jesus in A Course in Miracles, this is what he's pointing us towards, a new perception. He says you can change your perception of everything. In fact, it has to be of everything, no exception allowed whatsoever. God is shining as everything, not as almost everything, and God remains as nothing, not almost nothing. So it's not like that as God is shining at everything, there's something God is shining as that means that God is not remaining as nothing, that somehow this has changed, impacted God, and has depleted pure potentiality somehow. This isn't true. This is not true. So there's some sort of very deep-seated stress that has to do with thoughts and emotions, reactions, let's put that, reactions. Jesus calls it reactions. Ultimately, it's false creativity. It's imagining what if God didn't remain as nothing, shining as everything, but not remaining as nothing. How would that feel? And then these thoughts and emotions, we imagine, you know, what it would feel like. But ultimately, they're useless to us. They don't mean anything, because God does remain as nothing, shining as everything, remaining as nothing. It's not that God snaps back or bounces back to nothing, or there's a process of getting back to nothing. There's no process. God doesn't arrive back at being nothing. God doesn't depart from remaining as nothing and then have to return to it. There's no journey God needs to make. See? There's no transformation that has to take place. God doesn't have to change back to remaining as nothing. Doesn't need to be transformed. Doesn't need to transcend some condition. God, right this instant, is shining as everything, remaining as nothing. It's always been the case. There is nothing that needs to happen. As Ramana says, there's nothing to be achieved or attained or acquired anew. Just remove the camouflage. Just remove the camouflage. We're already that, shining as everything, remaining as nothing. So we're spending time here in great right-mindedness. You see, this is what the Holy Spirit's indicated. Just do this. This is what's, and of course a little banter is thrown in there, etc. Of course, we do have this pine cone, and you know, you just cannot get over this pine cone, and I have to brace myself just to hold it. I can't even, you know, I can use it to do reps with this. I gotta do reps. We do have that showing up. It's very important in some way. Maybe massive enlightenment, you know, massive or super heavyweight. Let's look at that. If pine cones symbolize spiritual enlightenment, maybe a super heavy one represents a super heavyweight. Now, this is possible, right? I mean, someone who's, you know, just a super heavyweight in enlightenment, like a Jesus, like a Rama Maharshi, you would call those super heavyweights. Huge elephants, super heavyweight. So it may indicate that a super heavyweight is coming. It may have multiple meanings, this, but we'll take it in the positive, that a super heavyweight. And inside, there are many, many huge pine nuts. That may mean many, many people come together and be very fulfilling. These pine nuts are very, very delicious and filling, very nutritious. So many will come gathering and be greatly benefited from this. Some super heavyweight is about ready to show up. Now, you know, if we were to be enlightened right now, would we be some super heavyweight? No. No, because we'd have to stabilize in it and get used to it in abidance, etc. But whereas a super heavyweight is one that is long since stabilized and abiding and is, you know, no possibility of being disturbed in or coming out of it in the slightest bit. And believe, no possibility of false belief. Not even belief, not needing even positive belief. So that'd be a super heavyweight. So it seems as though we're headed for a super heavyweight enlightenment. However you define it. If you look up pine cone spiritual significance, you know, spiritual symbol, it is like the ego, I could say, it's the preeminent symbol of enlightenment, of spiritual enlightenment. And we have this incredible pine cone here, folks. I mean, see, it's pretty cool. I mean, right? I mean, not every YouTube video channel has this pine cone, right? We've got a mascot here now, and it's pretty awesome. Yeah, I'll keep it. Maybe someday you'll be able to see it. Get your hands on it for yourself. I mean, imagine it's going to dry out at some point. Well, it seems to be awfully tough. I mean, its skin is just amazing. How anything like this could ever grow, you know? The vegetation is amazing. Everything here is amazing, really. The world's pretty amazing. And I'd love to see the world in a different light, you know? I'm so tired of seeing it in a negative way. Because it really, from the standpoint of mortal mind, it's so terrible, isn't it? It's so absolutely terrible. And it is absolutely terrible from the standpoint of mortal mind. But from the standpoint of eternal mind, it's completely delightful. Because nothing's happening. Everything is fresh. And it's not causing, it's not disturbing reality. God, nothing's being disturbed. What we call disturbances really are not disturbances at all. Nothing's being impacted. God remains shining. Everything remains as nothing. That's not changing in the slightest bit, ever. Very interesting. I was somewhere and I found this hammer, and I picked it up, and there's a stone there. I started hammering the stone to see if it was any good, and then suddenly the handle came off. I said, "Whoa!" That's not good. As I say, the wheels are about to come off this world. The blowout is about to happen. The tires are about to blow out. The handle is about to come off of the hammer. This is what I'm being told, shown this. You know, very graphic ways. I'm hammering the stone, which you might take as the world, and hammering, and then suddenly the head of the hammer just, you know, comes off because the handle slips right out. So that's why somebody didn't want it anymore. So the wheels are about to come off. Blowout's about to happen. This is what the Holy Spirit's saying. And we don't need to know exactly what's going to happen. It's enough to know, you know, the blowout's about to happen. What more does anyone need to know? To say, well, let's take shelter, take refuge from this. It's the left-minded people, you know, that they can't take shelter because they keep asking questions. They say, well, I need to be impressive. I need to make an impression here. No, you cannot impress God. Stop trying to impress God. Just take shelter. What you need to do is protect the understanding that you can't impress God. That's what needs to be protected. That's what's important, is I cannot make an impression upon God. And those who you'd say, hey, your house is on fire. They say, oh, really? Well, I'm going to impress you by asking a bunch of very interesting questions. Well, where did the fire start? At what time? Let's say your house is on raging fire, you know. Someone's screaming, get out, the house is on fire. And you say, I have a question, you know, do you know exactly what time the fire started? Well, you know, well, start about, I don't know, you know, half an hour ago, but it doesn't matter, it's raging. No, I mean, can you get it closer to, you know, was it 29 minutes ago, or, you know, it was 30 minutes, or the second, you know when it started? Do you know exactly where it started? Do you know exactly how it started? Do you know who started? Do you know why it was started? You know, how fast is it spreading? I mean, do you sit in your room as the whole house around you is an inferno? Do you sit around asking questions like that? Who does that? Well, apparently, most of the world is doing that right now. It's really that stupid, the world. Oh, I was started by gas. What type of gas? Was it leaded or was it unleaded? What was the octane content, and you know, of that gas? And how much gas was used? You know, how was it lit? I mean, you go on asking questions indefinitely, right, as the fire engulfs you. And you're saying, well, I'm being very impressive. I'm impressing. You know, impressing God. No. And because you're outsmarting yourself, saying, well, if I run outside, I'm trying to impress God. No, God can't be impressed. See? So, you know, whether you stay inside or run outside is equal as far as impressing God. Neither one's going to impress. So, why try to impress by not impressing? You know, that's stupid. Just get out of the burning house so you don't get impressed by the flames. I mean, the flames may make you believe that you're being God's being impressed, you know. That's more likely than getting out of the house, right? Not burning up. So we don't impress God by not being impressive either. It is very important. Yes, I know I'm absolutely impressive and absolutely not impressive. I'm being absolutely impressive and absolutely not impressive. I'm being absolutely impressive and not being absolutely impressive. I'm being impressive and not being impressive. I'm being impressive and not being impressive. Absolutely being impressive and absolutely not being impressive. I'm absolutely trying and absolutely not trying. I'm absolutely being impressive and not impressive. All sorts of unexpected commotions are just happening all over the place. A precursor, huh? That just shows what's to come, maybe. Yeah, from all angles. Stormy sea, stormy sea, stormy sea. It may not just be a singular tsunami. It may be just an extremely stormy ocean, right? Waves just coming at from all directions, getting tossed all about. This is very demoralizing, you know. It's like, well, we haven't sunk yet, but just being tossed to and fro, and it causes you to lose your nerve, and we don't want to lose our nerve. This is very important. So we need to take refuge, and hopefully there's a situation where we can take refuge, which would be a mind that's absolutely at peace, you know, a super guru, or many, I don't know, a parade of them, where they're absolutely certain that yeah, right now is there's no time taking place, is there's no impression upon God shining everything and remaining as nothing right now, always. There's no snapback. There's no nothing that God has to do in order to be this way. God already is this way. It's funny, I was at this place today where there was all this artwork for free, massive amounts of artwork for free, and I just said, no, you know, forget it. Don't need it. Don't need it. Big paintings. It was amazing. And the Holy Spirit said, forget it, right? You're not going to get those. I said, no, I don't need them. I don't need them. We just need this simple change, shift in perception. That's all. Vision of Christ, vision of oneness, vision of God. To perceive the world as God shining as everything and remaining as nothing. Just to perceive it that way, to feel it that way. When we have this feeling, everything we see will feel this way. This is how feelings work. When we're angry, fearful, everything seems, you know, threatening to us. When we have this absolute assurance of eternal life like this, then everything just appears to be benign and gentle and delightful and benign. It cannot disturb us. We cannot be disturbed. We cannot be perturbed. Nothing can hurt us. So why should we fear anything? Because what we are is the nature of God, and the nature of God cannot be disturbed. 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 And so when we see this, stop imagining that it can, then the whole world will appear to be extraordinarily benign to us. This is according to Jesus. He's very, very adamant about this, that we can see the world in a different way. But it's entirely benign, you know, super benign. It's not like we just, you know, are happy to see this person, or this person looks nice, or no, it's not like that. It's just everything is seamlessly benign. There's nothing that is not, nothing, you know, is disturbing at all. At all. Nothing is disturbing at all. What's going on? Okay. But all this disturbedness that we have, we can let go of it all, because it's just manufactured fake evidence. Reactions, thoughts and reactions are just supposedly proof of a disturbance in God. There's no disturbance in God, so we certainly don't need any to carry around any more false evidence, do we? See how simple it is? We don't need to carry around any more false evidence. sort of, there's some pressure I'm feeling. It must be that maybe some great enlightened being is about ready to come to our attention. And maybe I'm feeling this pressure, like maybe I'm not ready, you know, and I need to clarify this, clarify it more and more and more. I mean, this pine cone can certainly symbolize a great enlightened being, the arrival of a great enlightened being. And people always ask me, well, how'd you find it? And I say, well, it found me. It found me. It really did find me. And then, like Ramana says, keep on working with the light available to you, and you know, the master will find you, because the guru is seeking you. So you will be found by the teacher. It's not that you find, it's not so much that you find the teacher, it's a combination, but it's more that the teacher finds you. So this was just waiting there for me. It knew where I was going to be, and where I was going to be, and it was right there for me. You know, one in a trillion, one in beyond that. You know, it's such a extraordinary situation. So a super heavyweight enlightened being, one who sees, you know, vision of Christ, vision of oneness, vision of God perfectly, you know, is, and then, so the question was, would I pick this up? And I did, you know. I, as soon as I saw it, I said, "Ah, this is for me, no question. I'm gonna get this." It's right away. I was ready. I said, "I'm looking for something. Whatever catches my eye, I'm gonna get it." This is my attitude. And so, I picked it up, you know, brushed it off, and I said, "Well, I don't know what the heck this is, but I'm taking it. There was no doubt about it." So, that means that. You know, I'm gonna go for it. Whatever is there for me, I'm gonna pick it up and say, okay, let's go with this. And we're not far away at all from you know, the level of inquiry is very high here in these videos right now. It's very, very high. And we need not, you know, struggle and nitpick to think that, you know, we can improve upon it. The ego will say, "Well, you know, let's nitpick it." No, there's no need to nitpick it. We're very much in the ballpark. Very much in the ballpark. There's no reason, you know, to have some, you know, fundamental objection about it. We're very much in the ballpark here. So I feel very certain about that. I wouldn't have, you know, this massive pine cone would not have found me, you know, unless it's saying, hey, you know, you're ready for something massive. You know, something massive is going to take place, and you're ready for it. So, and by extension, you know, those who are able to entertain this are getting this pre-tan, you know, getting pre-tanned. Once you have a pre-tan, then you're able to go out in stronger sunlight. You know, if you don't have any tan at all, you tend to go out with diffuse light, right? Diffuse light first, not direct, and not maybe in the evening, in the morning, not in the midday sun. Once you get a good pre-tan, then you can go out in the midday sun, and you can also stay out in the sun a long time. And then you get a really great tan. But the first you need to build up a pre-tan. So that's what we've been doing with these videos, is to build up this pre-tan in with the belief that something extraordinary will take place here during these end times that we're in, these apocalyptic end times. We will have a great opportunity. This is the premise behind it. And even beyond that premise, just doing this will bring about our enlightenment. So it's a win-win, you know. Can't lose by doing this. It's an absolute win-win. Even if nothing took place at all, the very effort to get ready for something to take place will end up with our enlightenment. Absolutely it will. It's nice to have a carrot, you know, dangling there. It's like the chase, you know, nice to have a carrot. But I believe the carrot will arrive in one way or the other. I mean, you know, again, this pine cone is, you know, is here. It's not something I just, you know, saw and then came and told you about and said, "Well, I saw this great pine cone, blah blah blah," and people say, "Well, you know, where's the evidence?" Well, it's right here. It's right here. I mean, this thing is bigger than my head. It's bigger than my head. There's more wisdom in this than I can contain in my head, right? It's bigger than anybody's head. Holy cow, maybe I should put a hat on it, you know? I don't have any hats out here. I think I will. I'll put a little stand with a hat on it. I already see a stand for it, actually. I think I see one right here. And I got a lot of hats. I'll put those hats on it. Yeah, this is great. It's interesting. When I handle this, I seem to get this, you know, more stress. It seems to stress me. Interesting. There's a quality. There's some sort of mystical quality to it, actually. Yeah, I get shaky. Huh. Wow, that's really extraordinary. It has a physiological effect. I mean, emotion, it has some sort of spiritual effect. Shakes me up. People are reluctant to touch it and to hold it, you know, and then they hold it for a little while and they give it back like that. That's really extraordinary. It has an effect on people. Very much so. They get very animated. Very animated. Everybody, very animated. I haven't had one person say, "Oh yeah, what's that?" Shrug your shoulders now. You're very animated. There's something to do with just the sheer massiveness of this that is shocking. The sheer solidity of it. It's such a heavyweight. It's quite shocking. And maybe this is getting us ready for some, you know, tremendous great spiritual teacher like Jesus Christ. You know, just so solid, so unperturbed, so calm, such a heavyweight that it will cause us to come almost unglued in some ways. I mean, you know, we're used to some teachers here in the world that talk about the now and stuff, and maybe they've had a glimpse of it, maybe they abide in it to some extent, maybe they just abide in it. You might call them a nice pine cone, you know, but the difference between holding this pine cone and any other pine cone, I've held many pine cones in my life, the difference is like night and day. You just cannot get over what an effect it has upon you. It's unnerving. Has a very much an unnerving effect. Maybe it's some kind of touchstone, you know, kind of thing, where you can gauge where you're at, you know, by touching this or holding it. Maybe if the guru arrives, I'll give them, whoever they are. I'll say, "Here, hold this for me, and to see, you know, what the reaction might be. It's a nice touchstone." Yeah, maybe that's instead of asking them a question, I'll just hand this to them. Say, "Here, hold this." A tellstone. You know, it will tell, you know, what they're about. Separate the pretenders from the real thing. this thing is just so, I cannot, you know, it just, it hits a chord. I just cannot believe it. It's like a succulent, really, almost. It's a hard succulent texture to it. Very hard succulent. Like it was made of plaster of Paris or something, but not quite that. You know, it doesn't seem real somehow. It just does not seem real. Very unnerving. And so, you know, a great guru would just not like seem real to us, seem unreal. Nothing bothers you. Nothing can get to you. Nothing is disturbed. You're not disturbed at all. This is extraordinary. But now we know why. We know why now. It's very simple. I was meditating this morning, and before I got out of bed, and I was able to do deep, deep, deep inquiry. And I realized this is easy. This is simple. It's not difficult. It's really, really easy. And then when you come out of the meditation, it seems like, oh, you know, I must have done something really difficult. But the whole message of it was, no, it's easy. Really easy. So don't be disturbed. Don't be bothered by it. It's so obviously easy. You know, there's no problem at all. And we need to keep reminding ourselves of this. And this brings a wow to us. This is the trouble. The wow really kicks up when you tell yourself, it's just very easy. I won't have the slightest problem at all. Tell yourself that, and then you will feel a very strong wow. Very, very simple, very easy. You won't have any trouble at all. When you see it, you just say, oh, that's so easy, it's ridiculously easy. That's not difficult. Super heavyweight. This is no doubt a super heavyweight pine cone. No question about it. It's amazing. It just causes a reaction in everybody. Everybody has this. It's just, wow. I just cannot get over this. What it just it really does cause that reaction in everybody. Some kind of sacred talisman in a way, you know, right? There's something holy about it, something sacred about it, something primal about it. I think it was the Cretaceous Paleocene event, the KPT, Paleogenic, Cretaceous Paleogenic. That's when the Chicxulub impact greater than the asteroid that hit 6 kilometers. That's pretty big. If that was true, is true. 66 million years ago, the border between the Cretaceous, which is the last period of the Mesozoic, and the Paleogenic, phase of the Cenozoic, the oldest phase of the Cenozoic, 66 million years ago. This is what wiped out all dinosaurs. The I think the Cretaceous period was when the big dinosaurs dominated. You know, not the Jurassic, actually, not as much. It's different. You know, the some of the real big nasty dinosaurs we think of were the Cretaceous, the chalk era, where a lot of chalk was laid down by high sea levels. And that's when the asteroid just wiped them out. Massive, quick extinction of you know, was it 70% or something of the everything in the of the planet, oceans, you know, it's just drastic. And this tree, the Bunya pine tree, also got largely wiped out at that time. It used to be spread out throughout a lot of the world, actually. And then it was retreated to just Australia, where now it's just in this one little mountain range of Australia. This one little area. In, northeast Queensland, something like that? Northwest Queensland. The Bunya mountain range. This is the last natural standing area, you know, indigenous area of Bunya pines. Whereas they used to just, you know, be a very common feature of the whole world landscape of trees, along with some other conifers. These were here during the whole time of the Mesozoic era, basically. Just one little place that survived. Someplace sidestepped it, you know, sidestepped the trouble enough. And so then these have been falling here all during the Cenozoic era. Cenozoic era. These have been falling kaboom right in that area. Wham! And we have one right here with us now. We're just trying to let the wow dissipate a little here. It's very intense. And getting this close, it gets quite intense. This is what I'm experiencing. When you're talking about letting go of all your thought reactions, you see that they're not needed at all. You know, this is like, wow, this is, you know, wow. It's a close to panic time almost. So just wow, you just have to alarm, you know, so alarm goes off. Saying, no, I need that evidence, you know. It's important, it's vital, I need to judge. No, it's not. We don't need those reactions of fear reactions. We don't need them. We don't need fear, it's meaningless. It's much ado about nothing. It doesn't lead us anywhere. We we're doing here on the video. Okay. So I have to spend some time with this, because this is, we're getting so close now. Will we have a spiritual 9/11 event? Or a non-spiritual 9/11 event? I certainly want there to be a spiritual 9/11 event. Absolutely. We want to take the safe route and preempt anything that could possibly happen here. We want to preempt it. Given the totality of everything I've observed and been aware of, you know, it's wise to try to take a preemptive step here. Do not trust these times to be, you know, super conducive to realization that there's no such thing as impact on reality. It's much more likely that they're going to be the opposite of that. And, you know, just look at the news. Of everything you get in the world is just blasting you nonstop. Impact. Look at this impact. 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 Someone's been terribly impacted. Look at this terrible impact upon this situation, upon this person. You know, shooters impacting this, everything. It's all about impact. Impact. React. Impact. React. Impact. React. Impact. React. So, of course, you have to get out of this. If you're really going to get with this situation, you really need to get out of that, subjecting yourself to that. Don't subject yourself to that anymore. We're saying no impact, no reaction. There are no impacts upon God, no reaction from God. And God is the only nature there is. God is the only identity there is. God's got three aspects: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That is true. But it's only God, you know. It's only one God. Three aspects and one God. One dynamic that is both shining as everything and abiding as nothing. I think there's about over 30%, I think, of people, I think in the United States, a poll, believe that there's going to be some sort of extinction level event. Asteroids going to hit, you know, something. 30%. And then, of course, you know, close to 70 believe it will not happen. I mean, they believe, I mean, in their lifetime, 30%, over 30% believe in their lifetime, there's going to be some really, really catastrophic event. And you know, 60 plus say they don't believe that. That's 30%. That's a lot. That's quite a bit. So, you know, if you feel this, then you're certainly not alone at all. 3 out of 10. At least 3 out of 10. Maybe becoming more all the time. Boy, the tension is built back up again. It's extraordinarily strong. It must have something to do with some sort of breakthrough. Now, is anyone that is enlightened, are they a heavyweight? Well, relatively so they are. Relative to the other people here, others, you could say they're extreme heavyweights. Relative that way, you could say that. So it's really important, as this tension arises here, to have gotten on good habits here and get the jump on September. So I already have really good habits going on. And so I'm able to just stay with this in the right way. Otherwise, I think I would get pulled astray. For instance, I went on a diet. And if I hadn't gone on a diet, I think I would have just gone bonkers right now with this kind of stress. I think I'd just be eating cheesecake and, you know, and just go crazy. Just eat. I'd be a mess. This is how severe the stress is. Or watching the news, or getting pulled into this, you know, all this, you know, news stuff, news cycles, looking for clues. And that would just make things worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. So by getting a head start on this, it turns out to be exactly the right thing to do at exactly the right time. I'm able to at least use this tension to as motivation to do deeper inquiry. Is there an impact? Has there been an impact upon reality? Search it out. Is this I really an impact or false evidence? You know, the ego saying, I'm impactful. I'm very impactful. I want to be very impactful. I can... And a lot of people like to impact someone who's very clear. They want to impact them through confusion. They say, I can make you confused. This is very similar to what we're trying to do with God. We're trying to impact God and make God confused. So, you find that when you're very clear, other people try to pull you down. This can happen. And impact you so that you lose your confidence and your clarity and your poise. And so they can say, aha, you see, I can impact clarity and poise, and I can impact God. It reassures them that they can impact God. So they say, you see, the enlightenment is all false. That's false. You know, it's false. I'll just keep a construct, but enlightenment is false because I can impact God. You know, you have to somehow understand that it's both impactful and not impactful. You know? But not doing this as a practice, but doing this as a position. See, when we're practicing, we're not trying to take a position. We're practicing. This is what has to be understood, the difference between practice and trying to take a position. We're simply practicing, canceling out so we don't take a position. Whereas if you're not practicing, you can say the same thing, that it's both impactful and not impactful, as a way to take a dualistic position, saying I'm taking this position that we are impacting God in some ways and not impacting God in other ways. This is dualism, but there's really a singularity there too, isn't there? It really, the bottom line is God is being impacted. If you compare this to either God is not being impacted or is being impacted, taking the stance that God's being impacted in some ways, that's actually a singular stance, right? Compared to saying no impact. So then you try to say, well, I just mean, well, some impact, thinking that you're, you know, no, it is a singular statement, actually. Making it dualistic feels like you can trying to find a home within it and not realize that what you just did. But you really took we really took a complete singular extreme position that God can be impacted. So, if you're feeling a tremendous strain right now, just rely on your good habits and say, okay, look, my habits are great. I'm going to get through this. No question about it. Even though it's uncomfortable, I'm not going to make it worse. I'll be okay. I'll be okay. I'm just rely on your good habits, okay? Sitting quiet, sitting still, all the good habits that we have accumulated. Just rely on those good habits. Just rely on those good habits, and we'll manage to get through this. Don't try to do anything, extremely different. Just rely on the good habits. Don't say, wait a minute, I gotta go start riding a marathon. I gotta get in shape to run a marathon. Try to burn off the nervousness or something. Now just stay within, the practice, full stop in the wild practice. And gratitude. Yes, I'm absolutely grateful that I'm about to be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I'm about to be enlightened. That I'm absolutely grateful that I can be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I will be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I am enlightened. I take those three steps like that. I'm absolutely grateful that I can be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I will be enlightened. And I'm absolutely grateful that I'm already enlightened. That helped out. I'm absolutely grateful that I can be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I will be enlightened. I'm absolutely grateful that I'm already enlightened. I feel gratitude that I can be enlightened. I feel gratitude that I will be enlightened. I feel gratitude that I am already enlightened. Try this, yeah. Yeah, there is just a psychic shakeup going on that is just extraordinary. Really. So I'm so grateful that I can be enlightened. I'm so grateful that I will be enlightened. I'm so grateful that I'm already enlightened. I'm so grateful I'm already enlightened. So grateful that I can be enlightened. I'm so grateful that I will be enlightened. I'm so grateful that I'm already enlightened. The idea that we need some impact psyche and I psyche is not true at all. Not true at all. It's all fake. It's fake evidence. The whole I egoic psyche that we have with all its memories, reactions, and thoughts and impressions, etc., is all fake. We don't need it. I realized I never needed it. I never wanted it. I never believed in mortal existence at all coming here. I said it's all fake. It's not real. It's not true. So we don't need this I psyche at all. this whole complex we call the self, the false self, the I, the egoic self, we don't need it at all. We don't need any of it. And the great teachers, they don't have it. They don't have any of it. It doesn't exist for them. They realize, I don't need this. I don't need fake evidence that God can be impressed, impacted in some way. Impressed in some way. Why should I have fake evidence of that? Why should I be carrying around fake evidence of that and protecting this from truth? That's ridiculous. Okay, how are we doing? The timing is very good. Very great. Yeah, don't need it. Never wanted it. Never wanted it in the first place. Don't want it now. Never want it in the first place, and never want it in the future. Why do we need evidence, to cling to evidence of what never happened? Fake evidence of what never happened. People say, yeah, but don't you want when you die, don't you want to feel you've made an impression? No. I want to be sure I have not made any impression upon reality and know for a fact it's impossible. In fact, I want to know for a fact it's impossible long before I die. You know, otherwise I'll be suffering and suffering and suffering for a long time until I die. That's ridiculous. I want to know that it's impossible. No impression's ever been made. I haven't done anything. I haven't attacked God at all. Okay, well, the ego, didn't like that and was trying to get lost, you know, get me lost in the ego there. It was getting so intense there. So you just bring yourself back, okay? Full stop on the wow, don't wander. Full stop, don't wander. So this is not easy. You have to use your will, be very determined. Don't quit. Say, no, I'm doing this, I will. I can, I will. I already have succeeded. I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded. It's a fait accompli meaning, I've already succeeded. It's same as I has done. That's how it is. Since we cannot make an impact on God, our enlightenment is assured. Absolutely assured. It's already assured this very instant. Everyone's. And this is when you see this. One of the times I had a vision of oneness was I realized everyone is assured of enlightenment. We're all one family and we can't lose anyone. It's completely assured. Nobody can ever cause a problem for reality. And this was a tremendously happy experience. It was fantastic. So this is what we're very close to right now, except in more in an abiding sort of way, having great clarity about it. Everyone, this instant, their perfect enlightenment is absolutely assured. No exceptions.